This is a Blaring Out with Eric Blair show tonight at the 20th anniversary of the Newport Beach Film Festival for the premiere of The Tony Alva Story. And we're here with the original Z-Boy himself, Tony Alva. Tony, tell us a little bit about the film.
Well, basically, it's a documentary that I did with two friends that were originally from the East Coast, and they live here in L.A. It's Buddy and Rick Charnosky. And, it's my story, but it involves, like, a lot of the people that I not only sponsored, but that I've kind of grown up with and stuff. So it should be pretty interesting. It's at this point, it's at, like, the final version, too, of it, because we showed some rough versions before. And we promoted it and marketed it through what I do with Vans. But this is the finished one. So we could put it in this film festival and really show people, you know, basically, like, what my story has been like and what happened and what it's like now.
How do you deal with this fame, with this adulation all the time?
I just try to basically just be open-minded about it, you know, and appreciate the fact that I have fans and people that are a part of my story that look towards me for direction. And I try to have, you know, a sense of humility, really, because, you know, when I was younger, I was really arrogant and I had a lot of, like, obstacles to get through, you know, in life, and a lot of it just was due to the sense of ego, you know, that I had. But as the point that I'm at in my life now is at a really good place. I feel comfortable with who I am and what I've done, and I like to share that with people.
What inspired the surfers' aggressive and antisocial behavior in Dogtown during the 70s?
The spirit, you know, of surfing and stuff was kind of punk rock. Even before punk rock music became a part of skateboarding and surfing, we always kind of had that attitude because of the fact that we grew up on the streets. And the west side of LA has always been kind of a tough place to grow up. Even though everybody thought the east side of town was like the tougher side of town, the west side was pretty tough when we grew up. So, you know, it was a sense of survival. And I think with surfing and skateboarding, it kind of came out not only in our lifestyles, but also through our surfing and our skating. So that's why it was so radical, and I think that's why we spurred a revolution.
Do you think that's where the My Beach attitude came from also?
Well, you know, the territorialism of surfing and skateboarding was that, you know, there wasn't a lot of space for, I think, the popular kind of surge that came from surfing and skateboarding. So our crew was protecting really our spots from being invaded by other people that we didn't have any room for at that time. So, you know, and the territorialism, the localism that came from that, even though it comes from kind of an ignorance kind of attitude of, you know, my wave, my beach, all that. What it did, though, really was that it kind of took that culture to another level, I think, you know, and it made it really something special. I hate to say, you know, sometimes like territorialism can be something that kind of makes things a little bit harder to be a part of, you know, and people wanted that, you know, and people, I think people still want to be kind of a part of like what the Dogtown, that attitude symbolizes, you know.
How mind-bending was it for you in 1975 to see Skateboarder magazine documenting the rise of Dogtown?
Well, a lot of it had to do with being in contact with guys like, you know, Warren Bolster, Craig Stesic, having a relationship with Skateboarder magazine, being an amazing photographer, young guys coming up and out of the neighborhood like Glenn Friedman. I was around a lot of really good photographers at the time. Wynn Miller, who has quite a few photos in this documentary. And, you know, it was just, I was in the right place at the right time, you know. I was fortunate enough to grow up in a neighborhood where there was a window of opportunity, and just being in that situation, I think I just was intuitively at a young age aware of the fact that I had to take advantage of that situation to the best of my ability, like right then and there, you know.
Some of your fondest memories of the 1975 Del Mar Nationals.
Well, the Del Mar Nationals was pretty cool, you know, as far as like just us going there as a team. I think the team unity thing. But the most important thing to me was watching Peggy Oki go in there as the only girl on our team and walk away with the first place trophy. She was the one that won the first place. None of the guys did. Peggy Oki actually went in there and got a first place. And the judges didn't even really know how to judge her. She was so completely unorthodox, you know. So, yeah, I think a lot of the credit doesn't go to me. It goes to my peers, you know. It goes to guys like Jay Adams, Stacy Peralta, Bob Biniak, Wenzel Rummel. I mean, the list goes on, you know. We had a lot of talent on that team. And even though I was the guy that ended up taking it to the next level as far as like being a competitor and a fierce competitor, I still feel like being on that team and having all of these guys, you know, to push me to that level was really important, you know. And I think Peggy Oki was a big part of that too.
Tell me about punk rock, how you saw it, and what kind of people did you bond with?
Well, punk rock came later, you know. Like, I think with skateboarding, it's just like skateboarding became really aggressive, and it really went back to the streets. And when punk rock went back to the street, you know, when punk rock became a part of that back to the streets attitude, skateboarding went hand in hand with it, you know. And then a lot of us being musicians, that's where we started, you know, starting bands and learning how to play instruments and being a part of not only revolutionizing rock and roll, but doing it with that attitude that skateboarders had. Like, skateboarders always had a hardcore street sense kind of credibility to, I think, the culture that came from the streets. And punk rock became part of that, you know.
Do you think that's because the skateboard wheels hit the streets?
I think it's because our bodies hit the streets, man, before anything. And we knew how to fall and get back up and keep trying. Skaters have always been very resilient, but we're our determination factor is that we're used to falling and getting back up and trying it again and actually doing what we're trying to do without letting it break our spirit. You know, John Cardiel is a perfect example of that. He's going to be DJing here tonight at the party. He's one of those guys. You know, you can break my body, but you can't break my spirit. And those are the kind of guys I love, especially from a skateboarding perspective.
One of the things I've learned is no matter what, when you get knocked down, you have to get up in life no matter what. I don't care if you're sick or anything, because that's what gives you the energy to keep moving
forward. Well, that's where we learn, too, though. The trials and tribulations of life, they happen for a reason, you know? And it's to show our determination, our resiliency. It's to show our faith. It's to show basically like where we came from and why. Why we're skateboarders to begin with, you know, is because we're used to hitting the ground and getting back up and having to do it again. We keep doing these things because of the fact that we know we can be successful if we just don't give up. So that's part of the deal.
Well, and opposition does create character.
Definitely. I mean, look at Jeff Grosso. I mean, this is the guy that narrates the film and stuff. You want to talk about character as a skateboarder? It's this guy right here, Jeff Grosso.
Cool.
So I'm telling you, you know, we have a lot of character because we got a lot of characters in skateboarding. And Jeff's one of my favorites, you know. I love this guy. You're like a brother.
What kind of impact did it have on you to see Sean Penn's character, Jeff Spicoli, in the film Fast Times at Ridgemont High, wearing the sneakers?
Those are Steve's favorite shoes, the slip-ons with the checkerboard. You know, it makes me proud of Vans, if you want to know the truth. I think Vans, they started as a mom-and-pop shop, and they were my shoe of choice at a very young age. And the fact that we are one of the most successful, you know, sporting goods lines in the world, and we cater to skateboarding. And, you know, I mean, we're very, very fortunate to be as successful as we are. And the blessings are is that we have a guy like Steve Van Doren, that he's our ambassador, you know. I've known him basically since I was a kid, and I believe in the way that Steve runs his business. And I'm a part of that family. As you can see, I'm wearing the jacket where it says we are all Van Dorens. We're all part of the same family. And I believe in it. I endorse the product because of the fact that it's part of like who I am. It's part of my identity. But it's also part of being, you know, connected to Steve Van Doren and being connected to Vans and knowing that they got my back and that I'm a soldier and that I'm ready to go out and do the best that I can on a daily basis to promote and market and push Vans to the next level.
How have you avoided becoming a casualty of sex, drugs, and rock and roll?
I've been sober for almost 13 years. That's how I've done it. And I do it one day at a time. Just one day at a time. I don't use drugs. I don't drink alcohol. It's sobriety. Sobriety, and it's connected to spirituality. And my spiritual path in my life is basically that I don't use any mood-altering substances. I prefer to live a clean and sober lifestyle. And it's given me at least one, if not two more decades of being a professional skateboarder. I'm a surfer, I'm a rock and roll musician, and doing it sober, clean and sober, is the best. It's the best high you could ever experience in your life.
The highlights of being in GFP with Greg Hetson from Bad Religion and the Circle Jerks.
I love Greg Hetson, I love Joey C, I love all those guys, but the band that I'm in now is His Eyes Have Fangs, and it's with the Rainwaters and with a couple other musicians that are just amazing, clean and sober rock and roll musicians, and there's just nothing that compares to it. You know, we always have like fun doing what we're doing. We're prolific, but we do it for the right reasons, you know, and we're all connected spiritually. And that's what pushes our music and pushes our lives and everything that we do in a positive direction. And we're doing it for the right reasons. So
base of choice.
Fender Precision.
Love those precision.
Love that precision bass, and I like the Fender Dimension. And occasionally I'll play a Fender Jazz as well.
Fender Jazz, man.
Fender.
The tone.
Super bass. That's it. Super bass head, the whole deal.
You recently read the John Lennon biography.
Yeah.
What did you get out of that?
Well, I learned from not only his experience, strength, and hope, but I also learned from my mistakes and from the same mistakes that John Lennon made, because of the fact that he did have some issues with drugs and alcohol. He had some issues with his ego. And, you know, but at the same time, such a creative and a beautiful person, a beautiful soul, you know, looking and spreading the word, you know, of love and having a sense of, like, equanimity and peace in his life, finding the beautiful woman, you know, Yoko Ono, that became, like, a major beam in his life, a supporter of, like, you know, the ups and the downs that he had to go through, you know. And then his children carrying on as musicians now and being, like, amazing, like, extensions of his creativity, you know.
What do you miss most about Jay Adams?
Just his spontaneity and stuff. Christian, what do we miss most about Jay?
His unpredictable, almost contagious and addictive personality, because he would act what I call normal, in a sense of like what we try to act like certain things. He didn't try to act like anything. He was Jay Adams. He was pure. He was there was no impurities in him. He was maybe, you know, me and him did a lot of drugs. We did a lot of prison time. But at the same time, we were pure about our heart and what we were into. Skateboarding was his passion. It was what he did because no one told him to do it. He did it because he did it. And just like Tony Alva, you know, basically the leader, why Jay Adams fell in love with skateboarding was because of Tony Alva. And for me, they're the reason why I fell in love with skateboarding. And that tells me, you know what, there's something magical in their personalities, their talent, their gifting, but also their passion. I think the passion side is what overrode all the junk, all of the things that, you know, I've, you know, made mistakes over. But at the end of the day, it's about being pure and being honest.
And making progress.
With obviously our sobriety, stuff like that, me and Tony being, you know, almost like, you know, now people call us legends, you know. I mean, I think Tony's a legend, but now that I'm stepping into this kind of like light of that, but now we have a responsibility to like just
definitely.
Be leaders, be mentors. And I think that that's something that we're having a good time with.
It's amazing how I said the word spontaneity, but then he defined it. So we work good together, Christian and I, and we're brothers, you know, literally we are brothers. We're from the same family. We're from the same, that same blood, you know, of just the fact that surfing and skateboarding is like joined at the hip with us, and his father being, you know, from that culture and stuff, is that we grew up together and this is what we do.
The Blaring Out Show.